Katy Malone. I'm the Curator of Academic Programs at the McClung Museum at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. And today, as I work from home, I'm bringing you another How to Read an Object segment. And in this one, I'm going to tell you about one of the most important concepts for museum collections, and that's provenance. Provenance is a pretty complicated and serious subject. To simplify a little and to provide a basic illustration, I'm going to use something kind of silly, which are these plates of cookies. Let's get started. First things first, let's define provenance. In its most basic definition, provenance is the transfer and record of ownership. How an object moved from one place or community to a new owner. And let's look at that through my example. So this first plate represents the creator of an object. That creator could be the artist, a manufacturer, or a particular group or community that would have produced and utilized that object originally. This second plate represents the intermediary. That could be an art buyer, a descendant, a collector, or a gallery. And when provenance is clear and easy, the intermediary purchases or inherits the object directly from the creator. That transaction is clear, it has a legal written record, maybe like a bill of sale or a receipt, or is decreed in a will, and the transfer of ownership is documented. This third plate is the museum. So again, in the simplest terms, the intermediary approaches the museum with an object, and the object matches that museum's collection goals. So the museum accessions the item from that intermediary. An accession means the formal acquisition or taking in of an object into the museum's collection. And thereby, the museum holds all of the records of an object and the item itself in perpetuity for care. And perhaps in this instance, the object could be donated by a descendant. It could be bequeathed by a collector, or the museum could purchase the item from a dealer, like an auction house. And in any of these examples, the museum would have a clear paper trail recording the passing off of ownership from the person who made the item, or the item's original environment, to the intermediary, to the museum itself. And that's provenance. Easy enough, right? So, of course, we all keep records of every item that we have, just in case a museum might want it one day. Absolutely not. Of course we don't. And the lack of documentation of ownership can apply to any sort of item and can lead to a whole host of issues. Let's think through some of those problems. So provenance gets incredibly complicated when an object is especially old, or when ownership has changed hands many times. The more intermediaries there are, the more likely it is that there are gaps in the paperwork and records, or that there are records that never existed in the first place. And this can make it hard for a museum to know the full story of an object. Because let's be real about provenance. Provenance doesn't just track ownership. It tracks usage, it tracks changes, even damage. Anything that could add value or change the complex history of an object. And who owned something, how it was utilized, how it changed over time gives meaning and tells us about our world and society and how culture has shifted. Because objects tell stories, and provenance is a key to benchmarking those stories. Also, not knowing the provenance opens the museum up to some serious or even legal problems. Things like inheritances can be contested by family members, putting museums in the middle of really contentious or complex disputes. And believe it or not, there's a black market for art, cultural treasures, and even natural history objects. Reputable museums that are accredited would never knowingly engage with dealers that are trying to hawk stolen items, but having appropriate provenance and trusted sources is really key to protecting institutions from these bad actors. There's also the issue of fakes. More often than museums or collectors would care to admit, clever replicas, like this one, super clever, right? Real cookie, are passed off as the real thing. and paperwork can be falsified, objects can be produced that look like the real item. In these instances, subject matter experts like collection managers, appraisers, scholars become detectives, backtracking through records and examining items with specialized skills, looking for clues in archives or anything that would prove that something isn't legit. They may even analyze chemicals and compounds that comprise an object to test for things like age and materiality. Finally, as you can imagine, provenance gets complicated when an object is associated with oppression, violence, colonialism, or war. And let's think this through a little bit. The provenance of an object acquired during colonization of a community is questionable, to say the least, as they are often taken or given under duress. Was the object a gift given in good faith? Was it purchased at a fair price? Or was it removed from the creator without true consent? When it comes to times of war or violence, was the object stolen or looted from the rightful owner? History is fraught, which makes the acquisition of objects fraught. And by the time a piece of material culture has made its way to a museum, we can affirm that it's likely particularly valuable, special, rare, or even sacred. Museums obviously strive to be warehouses of humanity's most precious stories. And museums all over the world, ours included, have objects that were acquired under the guise of colonialism or violence. And in such instances, you may hear the term descendant community. So, for our purposes, descendant community refers to the group of people whose ancestors originally owned or created an object, whose ancestors lost ownership through oppressive, questionable means. When a museum has an object that was acquired through colonization or violence, those museums, including our own, then work to repatriate those materials. Repatriation, in short, is the return of ill-gotten objects to the descendant community. And it's dictated by national or international law in some instances, but it's also done because, frankly, it's the right thing to do. Now, repatriation is a critically important issue to museums and to descendant communities, so much so that it's a topic worthy of its own consideration. And I don't want to give it short shrift, so stay tuned for a follow-up examination. Before I go, I just want to make one final quick note. As you've heard throughout this video, I've been saying provenance. However, at some point you might hear the word provenience. And I want you to know that though they sound similar, provenance and provenience are not the same thing. Provenience is used primarily by researchers, like archaeologists or paleontologists, to describe where an object was uncovered, the place of scientific discovery, or recovery as it were, during an archaeological dig, or something like that. It's an important data point, and it's not provenance, but an object and have both provenance and provenience. Did you ever imagine that just thinking about who owns what could be so critical and complicated? How it has the potential to unravel fascinating stories? Tracking provenance can lead museum professionals into a world of intrigue and mystery, even social justice. And what I've provided here is a broad brush overview of its importance, and I hope that next time you're at a museum, you'll look more closely at a label next to an object to consider where and from whom that object originated, and think about how it got to where it is now. So with that, this has been Katy Malone, Curator of Academic Programs at the McClung Museum at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville, and I'll see you next time.